Thank you for joining us tonight. We have an outstanding program with David Marquis, the author of 3 books. He'll be discussing 2 of them tonight, I Am a Teacher and The River Always Wins. Plus, he has authored numerous essays and articles that have been printed throughout various periodicals and newspapers. I would like to also thank the Dallas Morning News for their generous support for publicizing this event. Thank you, David.
On the broad plain outside Taos, New Mexico, leading to the Sangre de Cristo Mountains, a bridge spans a deep, narrow gorge, and at the bottom of the steep rock walls is a river, the Rio Grande. The water roaring below, so distant as to be silent in its rushing, did not begin its long journey to the Gulf of Mexico. At the bottom of the gorge, it began on the top, on the surface, and over more years than could be known, the way the indigenous know the time to plant corn, or a mother knows to stroke a child's hair, or even in the soulless counting of seconds within a digital timepiece. The water found and caressed and forced its way through rock. When the snowmelt ran plentiful, the water worked on the rock. When drought came, the water, though less, worked on the rock. At no time did the water ever stop working on the rock. A single trickle, a single drop, constituted the whole of water itself, for its purpose and its nature are known to itself. And what is the nature of the river? The river is made of drops. Every river in the world, the Amazon, the Ganges, the Nile, the Hudson, the Mississippi, are all made of drops. One drop is one drop, is every drop. And rivers, ancient as days, may differ in the life along their banks, their depth, or the frequency of their flooding, but one thing is true. If enough drops flow together in the same direction long enough, the river always wins. There was a time in this country when women were not even allowed to vote, but the river won. There was a time in this country when black people were enslaved because of the color of their skin, but the river won. Through many centuries, gay people had to live in the shadows and hide their truest selves, but the river is winning on that issue and will continue to. If enough drops flow together in the same direction long enough, the river always wins.
David, you're a former Allen resident, and while you were teaching at Bowman Middle School in Plano, most of the times you got to your destination from Allen all the way to Bowman Middle School in Plano, which is approximately 7 miles, by bicycle. So that gave you a chance to look at I'm sure you took different routes, different days, and that gave you a chance to inspect Allen's environment. How did that shape your teaching career, and how did that shape your conservation efforts that you've championed many times over the years?
Well, thank you, Tom. That's a great question. When I lived in Allen from 1973 through 1975, it was a very special time in my life. I was just out of college. I had an old beat-up French Mercier. It was a French racing bicycle. So if you remember a young man with a big handlebar mustache and long blonde hair riding through the wheat fields of North Texas almost 50 years ago, that was me. So I remember those times clearly, because the young wheat, when it first came up, would be sparkling green before it reached its golden mature color. And being close to the land, I grew up in West Texas, close to land, and being in North Texas was a special time of my life because this was still a small farm town. Allen had 2,300 people in those days, and they didn't even deliver mail. You had to go pick up your mail. And that got me out of many boring faculty meetings. At 4:45, I'd say, hey, I gotta go. I gotta go pick up my mail. So being out in those wheat fields, being out in nature here was really special to me. And it did have a profound influence on me because it helped me understand the trade-offs that we were about to begin to go through. Let's remember that what's left of the Blackland Prairie from the time we began years ago, it's about 2% of it left, 2% of the prairie. But think of the trade-offs. This beautiful library, which is a great facility, and this beautiful theater space, those things are paid for by the growth in tax base. But what we've lost, of course, is a lot of that open land. So it was an important time in my life, a time that caused me to think very closely about our ties to the earth. I began to teach a lot of ecology and a lot of environmentalism, along with the American Studies curriculum I developed at Bowman in those days. So the ability to be out in nature and to live close to nature. I lived in a little house on the edge of town. There would be cattle that would wander through my yard. And years later, I was asked to write a play called The Land, about land conservation. And by the time that happened in 2005, I had spent a lot of time in the ecology movement. And let's take a moment and teach. Okay, let's take a moment and teach. The word eco, economics, ecology, ECO. You know what that comes from? It comes from a Latin word, oikos. Actually, it's a Greek word, oikos. It means house or home. So ecology, the ecology movement, comes from a study of or the story of our house, our home, which of course is this planet. So that ability to be close to the land influenced my teaching. It later influenced me when I worked on the Oak Cliff Nature Preserve, which I established and founded in 1999, one of the premier urban nature preserves in America. And Tom, you've done some serious conservation work also. But we, I think we look at North Texas today, and we still have places like Connemara. We have forest near Allen. We have a great park system in Plano that help us be close to nature. But we must always remember that our ties to nature are innate there within us. And there's a growing body of evidence. This is really interesting. Laura Bush, former First Lady Laura Bush, founded an organization called Texan by Nature, which now is working with medical systems and hospital systems all over Texas. And they have developed a growing body of data that being outdoors is good for you. There are actually doctors today who will write you a prescription to go for a walk in nature. Now, we might know that intuitively, but now the evidence, the data actually is building that demonstrates that, that something we've known a long time can be proven scientifically. So if you're ready, I think we'll do a piece from my play, The Land. Let's set the scene here. I was approached about 15 years ago to write a play about land conservation, and I did. And that play went on to tour Tennessee, Texas, California, and it made a very strong statement about the relationship between humanity and Mother Nature and this planet. So during the play, at one point, Mother Nature conjures up a tree in the middle of the stage. And my character, kind of a driven type A, pave over the world guy, has to begin to return to his ties in the land. And this particular scene is about that character encountering a tree and what he begins to understand from that tree. So this is a scene from The Land. Old-time tree men will tell you that every tree is an individual. Not just that the oak is different from the pine, but that every oak is different from every other oak. Each tree an individual. Storms, ice, disease might affect them differently, but each one is an individual. Now, we spend billions of dollars on solar energy research, photovoltaic cells, solar panels, but from the moment light first touches this tree, first thing in the morning, it just soaks up all that energy. It provides shade, a sound barrier, a windbreak, and it can take its roots and wind them down through the earth looking for moisture, thin as silk ribbon. It might take 300 gallons of water a day out of the earth and then give it back to you through the evaporative process of its leaves. Now we, as we age, we begin to lose our memories, but the rings of this tree can tell the difference between the wet years and the dry years, the winter rings and the summer rings, whether it's been through a fire. And those memories do not fade. Now, we think we're so special. We think that multitasking means being able to talk on our cell phone while we fold the laundry. But this tree, why, this tree can do all those things at the same time every day. One tree, one day. What have you accomplished since you got up this morning?
Every teacher in this country, from preschool to graduate school, has had challenges to address, both in the classroom and outside the classroom. Can you identify some of the challenges you had when you were a teacher, how you overcame them, and perhaps name some of the students and how y'all have kept up over the years?
Tom, I would be willing to bet you that right now there are students out there watching who are in my classroom at Bowman Junior High, today Bowman Middle School. But I would be willing to bet you that Kim and Kathy and Jonna and Lee and Lisa and Renee and Jeff and Skip, I bet you some of them are watching now. And some of my students from later on, Fernando and Lateris, some others might be watching also. But when I came to Bowman Junior High, I was 22 years old. I was barely older than they were. And I began to understand at that point in time the challenges American education was facing. For a long time, communities had been stable. You had the same students and the same teachers year after year. In Plano, it was growing so fast that we had an enormous influx of new students every year, and Plano was hiring about 20% new teachers every fall. So there was enormous turnover, enormous change, enormous overcrowding in the schools. And so the ability to deal with those larger and larger class sizes with more and more new students and new teachers that didn't have those long roots into a community the way that I did, or perhaps you did growing up. I grew up in Lubbock. I went through school in the same schools that my brother went to, people in the community went to for years and years and years, had the same teachers for many, many years. And yet in Plano, those changes were coming so fast, we had to address them and do it in such a way that we could provide more than a basic education. In my second year of teaching, I developed and taught an American Studies curriculum. We took 50 ninth graders, 2 hours a day, and we studied America through art and architecture and history and dance and music and every possible discipline you could think of to study American culture. And we had challenges. We had challenges throughout Plano at that time. And some of those challenges had to do with the fact that, well, let's be honest, with the fact that sometimes the Plano ISD, which has had a lot of great people work there over the years, maybe they weren't always ready for a free-spirited young teacher with a big handlebar mustache and long blonde hair. So I was always in trouble with the administration, constantly. But I was blessed in having a great principal, a man named Tom Moore, who passed away a few years ago. And Tom Moore actually defended me once. A school board member said, I hear there's some creative young teacher over there at your school, teaching all kinds of things. And Mr. Moore told this school board member, he's a great teacher, leave him alone. Not many principals would do that. But I've always been thankful to the man I consider the late, great Tom Moore, who stood up for me. So after 2 years here in Plano, living in Allen, I knew I was going to have to find a bigger classroom, some other place where I could really spread my wings and teach the way I wanted to. So I really believe that much of what I've done in my life has been that effort to find that bigger classroom, so I can teach and speak and perform the way that I want to, write what I want to, and yet see all those things in some way tied to those early years. And let's teach again for another moment. We've become so overwhelmed in American education with standardized tests, with very standardized curricula. And yet, if you look at the word educate, an educator. It actually comes from a Latin verb, educare, which means to call forth. Education doesn't mean to inform or to give standardized tests or to try to fit everyone into the same mold. It means to call forth, which to me would mean that you want to bring out the light in those students and you want to find what moves them the most and help them become their fullest selves, help them become a lifetime learner. And so during that period of time, just after I left Plano, one of my students, one of my former students from Bowman, was very tragically shot to death. And they got the news on a Saturday afternoon while watching a college football game. And it really broke my heart because a lot of us tried to help get this kid going on a good path, and then he was shot to death. And I sat down not long afterwards, and I wrote a play called I Am a Teacher about what it means to be a teacher who really cares about kids. And that play went on to tour for almost 2 decades. It became a trilogy of plays. I Am a Teacher, Part 1, about a young teacher full of hope and inspiration and eagerness. Part 2, about a middle-aged teacher who has been through the ringer for a while. He's becoming cynical, not sure he's going to stay in the classroom. And then Part 3. And Part 3 is about a teacher at the end of his career. So it's a trilogy that covers the life of an American teacher. As far as we know, no one else in American theater has ever done that. Let's take a moment and do a scene from I Am a Teacher, Part 3. Now let's set the scene. I play the part of Ben James, a ninth grade American history teacher, just as I was a ninth grade American history teacher. And in this play, Part 3, Ben James has been asked to mentor a first-year teacher, a brand new teacher, a young man named Jeremy Montgomery. So the scene you're about to see takes place on the first day of school in Jeremy's first year of teaching. Ben James and Jeremy Montgomery. So, Jeremy, they've asked me to mentor you this year. Is that okay with you? Okay. All right, we'll give it a try. So now let me ask, what do you teach? 8th grade math. God bless your heart, son. Jeremy, do you drink whiskey? Oh, you will. Listen, Jeremy, do you have any idea what's about to come at you this first day? Do you have any idea? Oh, there it goes. First bell of your first day of your first year. Jeremy, let me tell you something. You're going to walk in that classroom and 35 kids are going to walk through the door, and in an hour the bell's going to ring again and those kids are going to come in again, and then it's going to ring again. They're going to keep coming like waves on the beach, and they're never going to stop. That's what you're in for, Jeremy. So you listen up. If you want to be a teacher, you listen to me right now. Jeremy, be a leader. A teacher is a leader. You have to go in there, look them in the eye, take them by the hand, and lead them somewhere. And if you do that, they will come with you. They will come to trust you. Respect, yes. Learning, yes. But they have to trust you. You must promise me today, Jeremy, that no matter what, you will not commit the crime. The crime is not low test scores. The crime is to diminish the light in your students' eyes. Every human being, Jeremy, is born with light in their eyes. Think of it. We're born to it. Sight and sound and touch and taste and feeling and language and cognition and memory. We are born to learn. But by now, Jeremy, many of those kids in your class, that light has already begun to flicker out. So Jeremy, promise me, you will guard the light in your students' eyes. Be a leader. Be their teacher. Now, Jeremy, listen to me. You go in that classroom. That classroom is your turf. You go in there and you take that. And you be on fire to teach them. Be a teacher, Jeremy. Go. the years of I am a teacher in my life led me to understand that I had found that larger classroom. There were times, Tom, that teachers would come up to me after the show and say that someone finally understood their life. There were times that young people came up to me and said they decided to become a teacher because they saw the play. To this day, I still hear from people all over America. There's a man watching right now from Rochester, New York, who wants me to bring I Am a Teacher back. He saw all three versions. He used to work at Kodak. Kodak one time flew me to their corporate headquarters in Rochester, New York, to do the show for nine people in their corporate boardroom, nine executive vice presidents. And they used their response to the play as a way to decide how to spend millions of dollars of their corporate money to address educational issues. Bank of America once put together a statewide tour to go all over Texas and recruit future teachers. A gifted artist and photographer named Robin Sachs, also a former teacher, worked with me, and we did a book back in 1991. It came out, became a Critics' Choice in Time magazine, had an enormous impact on education, and it was a tribute to America's teachers. So the I Am a Teacher play is extremely important to me, and I'm thankful that I had the opportunity to do it. And now I think it's time to look at what comes next with I Am a Teacher. Will Evans, the publisher of The River Always Wins, who's a great publisher. I love being with Deep Vellum as my publisher. Sarah Balabalilar and Lindsay King, the great team there, Will. Now we're talking about publishing I Am a Teacher now, the entire trilogy of plays, so we can release the rights and then anyone can produce it anywhere. Because it's clear, especially as we come out of the pandemic, teachers have been under enormous stress, having to learn new ways to teach remotely and virtually, and now coming back, going back into the classroom, facing issues again in person. So I think the time is right to bring I Am a Teacher back. But I cannot even begin to tell you how many times people have come to me and told me how much that play meant to them. I was walking across a parking lot one night, a dark parking lot, after seeing a Rangers game, Texas Rangers, looking for my car, big dark parking lot. And a voice called out, "Are you David Marquis?" And I turned around and looked, and this gentleman came up to me and said, "Are you David Marquis?" And I said, "Yes, I am." And he said, "I saw you do I Am a Teacher." And he told me where. And I realized it was about 20 years before. And yet he still remembered that and how it made him feel as a teacher. So I think we're going to need to bring that one back. But thank you for asking about it, because it's a major piece of writing in my life and something that allowed me to find that bigger classroom.
I think if you've encouraged teachers to stay in the profession and also to enter the profession, that speaks well of the influence of your book.
Thank you.
The what teachers and or professors influenced you and why?
I had so many great teachers. Lubbock had a school district that had a lot of teachers who had been there a long time, the old-fashioned West Texas school marm. They had been there for years and they really knew how to teach. And as a result, I was lucky to have that excellent public school education. There's so many. Mr. Reeves, Miss Honey, Miss Bussey. It's a long list. But there was one great teacher in my life who made so much difference. Her name was Mamie Porter. She was my high school speech teacher. I didn't want to be in speech. I was an athlete. I didn't want to be in there, but my parents insisted I take the class. And over a period of time, Mamie simply allowed me to begin to discover that I could stand up in front of people and somehow move them or inspire them or cause them to think or to take action. And Mamie was the great teacher of my life. When I played the Kennedy Center, we got American Airlines to donate some tickets and flew her to Washington, D.C., and I brought Mamie up on stage at the Kennedy Center as a way of thanking her. And when we did the I Am a Teacher book, I dedicated the I Am a Teacher book to Mamie Porter because he was a great teacher in my life. And I'll tell you a quick story that I think is a very soulful and moving story. As Mamie was nearing the end of her life in Sherman, where she retired, her daughter called me and said, you know, Mamie's not going to be here much longer. We want you to do the eulogy at her service. So the time came, I got the call, I drove up to Sherman, I did the eulogy, we buried Mamie, buried my teacher that day. And I was driving back through the rain to Dallas, so much on my mind, teaching and teachers and the importance of them and the great teacher in my life. And I called my wife, I said, Dinah, let's just go out to dinner tonight, call somebody to go with us. And our good friend Edwin Cabanis, who owns the Kessler Theater, joined us for dinner. We were sitting in a little Mexican cafe in Oak Cliff, and we were talking about teachers and teaching and the great teachers in our lives. And the door to the cafe opened, and a young woman walked in. She had been one of my students years before. I had taught her creative writing. And she walked directly to me and threw her arms around me and said, thank you for being my teacher. Now explain to me how on that day, when I buried Mamie and eulogized her, and we were sitting in that cafe of all the Mexican cafes in this part of the world, on that day, that student walked in, walked right to me, and said, thank you for being my teacher. That is the soul of a teacher reaching across generations. And I do believe that teaching is a very soulful and very human enterprise.
I think one of the lessons to be garnered from that experience is the importance of thanking your teacher, even after you've left or graduated. And I know that in years past, when I wanted to thank a teacher, it was hard to find them because they'd moved or gone to another state. But with today's internet, there's so many billboards posting places that you can thank your teacher. So thank your teacher. Even if she was in first grade, how do you envision the future of education the changes you would like to see in the future?
I think we have to become education that emphasizes doing, and I think we have to be an educational universe that now offers so many different ways to learn. We have vast amounts of information. We also know, though, that the socialization process of being in a classroom with other people is really important. So I think there's something we need to do, which is to understand that once a person can demonstrate proficiency in language arts and social sciences and science and math and so on, then why in the world shouldn't they go out into the world to explore further? Why shouldn't some teachers be able to take field trips across the world for children of all ages, not just seniors in college or juniors in college? Why shouldn't we encourage people to go out and do things and explore in ways? Because once you have that proficiency in those basic ways, why continue to sit in a classroom day after day? You know, the idea that the teacher is going to be someone who sits or stands in front of a class of 30 people who are sitting in rows and lectures to them day after day, that's still the basic model we work on. And if anything good comes out educationally from the pandemic, it will be that we can understand that we can have hybrid forms of education, and that education should be based more on doing and not just on absorbing knowledge. Again, educare, to call forth. That's what we need to be doing. We also need to identify those who learn well early in the morning and those who learn well later in the day. Why is everybody in school at the same hour every day? Now, it might be convenient for administrators, it might be convenient for some families, but at the same time, we know there are teachers and students who do better first thing in the morning. Well, let's get them there first thing in the morning. If you're more of a nighttime person, why shouldn't that school offer more classes at night? Somebody might need to work during the day and then come to school at night. Now, at least, we're offering dual diplomas where you can get that high school diploma and the associate's degree at the same time. That's a step in the right direction. But we need to break down these systems of education, because I can guarantee you this was one of my great frustrations as a teacher. It was very clear to me we were not administering schools for the sake of the student. We are administering schools for the sake of the bureaucracy. And that's unacceptable. Our schools have to exist for the sake of educating children and bringing them forward. And if we're doing anything less than that, then we are on the wrong path. I do think also that we need to keep in mind that we need two different kinds of teachers. We need informational teachers, those really solid teachers who are well-organized, they're prepared, and they can deliver lessons in such a way that are engaging and interesting for a broad variety of students. We also need inspirational teachers. We need teachers who are free spirits, the surfers and the cowgirls, and the singers and the dancers, the artists, who inspire learning in such a way that they find those students who really need that outlet and are ready for that outlet in their life and don't need to be sitting in a chair hour after hour, day after day. Find that kind of blend of teachers, the informational, the inspirational, bring them together, keep our principals in our schools longer so they can develop a real identity for that school, for how that school operates, and work from that basis. If we'll do that, I think we can break down some of the systems that have too often forced us into this standardized curriculum that's been killing American education for years. You know what the number one factor in standardized test score success is in the SAT? It's household income. Household income is the number one single greatest factor in how someone does on the SAT. Well, guess who that's going to benefit? So we're beginning to break these systems down. We need to continue to do that.
When you left Plano, you developed a recommendation. And tell us how that was initially shelved and what happened to it.
Oh, man. Oh, I'm so glad you asked that question. So I didn't get along with the administration. By the end of my second year, they did not want to allow me to teach American studies any longer. They were going to take that course away from me. I think if you ask some of my kids from those days, those kids are 60 now, they would tell you that was a great class. But the administration was not going to allow me to teach that any longer. So I left. And I wrote them a 13-page letter of resignation. 13 pages. And I went up to school and I used their mimeograph machine to copy it and staple it. And then I got it to all the school board members, all the principals, all the assistant principals, all the administrators in the district, all got that letter of resignation, 13 pages, full of recommendations for ways to improve the Plano Independent School District. I was 24. And it was the Plano ISD, this vaunted, honored school district. And here's this 24-year-old, the 13-page letter of resignation tossed on their desk. So years later, I think it was about 5 years later, I got a call from a friend who was still in Plano ISD. He was an administrator. He found it in his desk. He was cleaning out his desk, and he called me. He was laughing. And he said, "You know, Dave, I was cleaning out my desk, and I found that letter of resignation you wrote us. We were so upset. We were so indignant that you would have the gall to tell us how we could change our school district. But I can tell you today, we have now implemented all of those recommendations you made to us." So years later, the wise guy, 24-year-old, 13-page letter of recommendation did indeed change the Plano Independent School District.
Can you tell us about one student who is now chancellor of a major university?
Oh, you bet I can. Young man named Brian McCall. Brian was a 9-term member of the Texas House of Representatives from Plano. Outstanding legislator, one of the best we've ever had in the state. And he was my 9th grade English student. When I went to testify to the legislature a couple of years ago, he came to hear my testimony. Brian is now the chancellor of the Texas State University system. He's doing a bang-up job. They have built, I think, 83 new buildings under his leadership. So there is a young man from my class, ninth grade English class, fourth period, I think. It's a class I used to use a lot of J.J.F. Walker and Marvin Gaye to teach them metaphor and simile. But Brian was a great young student. He's an outstanding citizen and a great chancellor of a great university. Thank you for asking that.
You had mentioned that one of the issues that they had a problem with you about is because you would take your kids on field trips. Can you tell us about those field trips and how harmful they were to those kids?
Oh, my God. That's just undermining the pillars of society. I wanted to take my American Studies class on a field trip to see the great American drama Inherit the Wind about the Scopes Monkey Trial, when a teacher in Tennessee about 100 years ago was put on trial for teaching evolution in the Tennessee public schools. That play premiered in Dallas at the Magnolia Lounge in 1955. So the Dallas Theater Center was doing a new production of it. This would have been 1975. And I wanted to take my kids to see this production. And I was told, oh, no, Dave, you can't do that. You cannot take kids to see Inherit the Wind. That would be way too radical. We can't have that here. Come up with something else, and you can take them to something else. So I took the entire American Studies class, all 50 of them, to a Texas Rangers baseball game as a way of studying American values as reflected through sports. In baseball, the sacrifice bunt, you sacrifice yourself for the good of the team. You can argue with the umpire, but the umpire is the ultimate authority. So each student had to write a paper about American value as reflected through sports based upon what they learned at that Friday night baseball game between the Rangers and the Angels. And a young pitcher named Frank Tanana relieved Nolan Ryan, who was pitching for the Angels in those days. But we took 50 kids to a Texas Ranger baseball game because they will not allow me to take them to see Inherit the Wind.
Do you want to give us a reading of your next book?
Oh, sure. I'd love to. Will Evans at Deep Vellum and I have talked about doing the River Trilogy. The first one, The River Always Wins. And I'm going to go ahead and mention here, yes, you can get it on Amazon. You also can get it at bookstores. If they don't have it, they can order it. You can get it at Deep Vellum on their website, Interabang Books, or also bookshop.org, which is kind of a nonprofit, independent Amazon. We also have an audiobook on Audible and also on Libro FM. So here's The River Always Wins. And I want to take a moment also, Tom, and thank Kirby Gand, who designed such a beautiful book, and Justin Childress, who designed the covers. The cover is different from the hardback and the paperback. They're both beautiful covers. The team that worked on this just did such a beautiful job, and the writer often gets all the credit, but Will and Sarah and Lindsay and Justin and Kirby, all those people deserve credit also. So, The River Trilogy. The second book will be called The River of Goodness, based on the central thought that each day, each of us has to wake up and make a choice, and that choice is, do we accept the world the way it is, or do we work to make it better? And then the third of the trilogy will be called The River of Blessings. Goodness we earn, blessings we receive. So let's do a brief reading from the very beginning of The River of Goodness. The River of Goodness, chapter 1. The work of goodness never ends, never. Never ends. It is work, the toil of a muscular soul, not the pretty muscles of a gym, but the enduring sinew, endurable flesh of daily labor. Goodness is steady rain, not a filmy gossamer mist that runs at the first sight of morning heat. Goodness does not descend from above like a baby's blanket unfurled and settling upon the infant. Oh, goodness comes up out of the ground, the harvest of the crop of the seeds of the soil, the breathing soil of the earth, ancient and wondering, waiting, wondering. if we will ever get it right.
Tell us about the bicentennial celebration in Allen, Texas on July 4th, 1976.
Oh, my. That is quite a memory. And thank you for raising that, because it's a wonderful memory. But I had moved to Allen in 1973, so by 1976, I'd been there 3 years. I'd left the Plano Independent School District and begun to write and perform. So one of my very, very early shows was during the bicentennial. It was called Celebrate America. It was a celebration of American life and American culture during our 200th birthday celebration as a nation. And on the 4th of July, 1976, I was the featured speaker at a civic bicentennial celebration in the Allen High School football stadium. Of course, in those days, the high school football stadium was very small, you know, a small town football stadium. But they built the stage out in the middle of the stadium. I guess it was on the 50-yard line. And I was out there by myself in the middle of the football stadium with a microphone. And the town was there. Pretty much everybody turned out. They were sitting there in the sweltering sun, just as I was standing there in the sweltering sun. And I did this show, which I did in, I think, 5 different states, maybe. It was my very first tour. And I remember playing, Oklahoma and Colorado and Texas and, you know, I don't know, some other places. But it was a very special time for me, because by then, I knew people in Allen, they knew me, and the fact that this small town of good people turned out on a blistering July 4th afternoon to sit in the stands while I stood in the middle of the football field and did this one-man show on a bare stage with one microphone was just really a very special experience for me. And it let me know that things were going to work out for me, because if I could hold their attention on that afternoon for the period of, you know, a one-man show, in those circumstances, I knew things were going to work out. So that was a very, very special memory of me, of my career, and early in my career, because, you know, that was the first one-man show I ever did. And I did it there. And here's another interesting piece. Someone who was there that day was the librarian of the city of Allen at that time. Her name is Mary Soom. And she later became city manager of the city of Dallas. And when I did the Oak Cliff Nature Preserve and founded that, Mary was city manager there. And we had met in Allen at a book sale of some kind at the library, the old library, over there by First Christian Church, was in this little house, these beautiful stained glass windows, and there was a curve that you came into town on, and it came into Main Street. And I met this young woman named Mary Soom. And then years later, we became very good friends when she was city manager of Dallas, and I was very civically involved. And we still are good friends to this day. But she was in the stands that day on the 4th of July, 1976.
Tell us about your recollections of Pete Ford.
Oh, man. When I first moved here, I'd gotten the job at Bowman Middle School, Bowman Junior High in those days. And I wanted to live someplace. It was kind of in the country. So they said, well, go to Allen. It's still a small town. Plano was booming. Allen had not begun to boom yet. So I was driving into Allen, and I saw this place, this sign that said Pete Ford Real Estate. And they said, yeah, I think it was at the service station. I mean, I didn't know anybody. They said, well, go find this guy, Pete Ford. So I went in, I found Pete Ford, the nicest guy in the world. And he had a rent house that was available. And the rent house was off of Ash Lane. As you came into town, there was a little IGA, a little grocery store. And you turned left onto Ash, and you went past the grocery store, you went down a little bit, and took a right, and went down, and Pete showed me this house. It's a little house. You walked in, there was a kitchen, 2 bedrooms, 1 bath, a little den-like area, and it was great, except when it rained hard, the water would run through the house. And I swear, this is 1973, my first house out of college. The rent for that house was $135 a month, and I had a roommate. So my rent, of course, I was a young teacher, I was making zero. My rent in Allen, Texas in 1973 was $67.50 a month. And Pete was so kind. He'd come by once a month and get the rent check, and we'd catch up and visit. Just the nicest gentleman in the world, the kind of guy that small towns are built around. Every small town has to have a Pete Ford. And I remember that little house so well because it was really in the country. Cows would wander through my yard, and there was a little cornfield off to one side. And I'd find raccoons and skunks and all kinds of things. There were horses across the street. And there was a small black church across a field, and I would guess it was 40 yards away. And you told me that church was still there. And I drove over there the other day, and that church is still there. The two houses I lived in one off of Ash, and I lived in one on Cedar Street. And both those houses are long gone. So I feel totally written out of the history of Allen because both those houses are gone. But I remember clearly, I would come home from school, from teaching. You know, and teaching is exhausting. So I'd come home and I'd go down and dribble the basketball down to First Baptist Church, which in those days was a very small church, with a little basketball goal out behind it. And I'd go down and shoot some baskets and eat the cookies the girls in home ec would make me and bring to my classroom. But on Wednesday nights, that church would open its double doors and the preacher would play the blues and preach. He had this big red Gibson guitar. And he would stand in the doorway of that church and sing the blues and preach. And I would get a lawn chair and go out there with a lawn chair and the Dallas Times Herald. Of course, the Times Herald in those days was the evening paper. It's gone now. But I didn't have time to read the morning paper because I was on the way to school. So in the evening, I would read the Times Herald and sit in a lawn chair and drink a Budweiser. Remember those days when beer was Budweiser or Budweiser? There were no pale ales or craft breweries. It was Budweiser. So I'd sit out there on a Wednesday evening and listen to this great blues singer and preacher preach and sing the blues while I drank a beer and sat in my lawn chair and read the evening paper. And Allen, Texas, to me, holds so many memories like that. Riding my bike through the wheat fields, going to the Dairy Queen, playing basketball down this little goal behind First Baptist, and listening to that wonderful preacher preach and sing and play that big red Gibson guitar. But that's a memory as clear as day. I was 22 years old. I'll never forget it. So I want to thank Allen, Texas, for being a big part of my life and a big part of my career. I still remember back to that July 4th, 1976, I still remember coming off stage and thinking, if I can do that, I can play anywhere. And then later on, I did play pretty much everywhere in touring 40 to 50 states and playing every kind of venue. But I played the football stadium in Allen, Texas. If you can do that, you can do anything.
So it encouraged you.
Yes, without question. The people in Allen were so kind to me. You know, they didn't really know me. They knew I taught in Plano, had a few friends here. But the city in general encouraged me, and that particular event really encouraged me. And I've always been appreciative of the people at Allen who, you know, took me in for 3 years, you know. Got to know the people at the grocery store, some of the people at the church, some of the people like Pete Ford, who had been here a long time. And I just had a really great sense of the people here and got to know the people at the service station who repaired. I had this old Volvo way back in the day, you know, when they were, Volvos were just these boxy cars made out of iron, and they worked on my Volvo. It was a salt of the earth small town and a great place for a young man to begin to find his way in life.
Did Pete Ford share with you any of the Dust Bowl days or the Depression days?
Not so much. I mean, we talked about a lot of things. He was always very friendly. My family grew up during the Dust Bowl. in the 1930s out in West Texas and in New Mexico and Oklahoma and Kansas. But I'm not sure I've ever heard Pete tell those stories. It would not surprise me. I do remember that Pete would come over and I'd give him the check, and we would talk a long time. He was an old-fashioned guy who understood that much that had to do with the goodness of the community was knowing each other and not being in a rush, not being in a hurry. Things today are so rushed, in such a hurry. And Pete Ford would take the time to get to know people. And I think that's one of the reasons he was so beloved in the city, is that he would take the time to get to know you. And that was really special to me.
He was very supportive of the Allen school system. And if there was a bake sale, he always bought a cake.
Yep.
If there was a car wash, he made sure his car was washed.
Yep. Yep. Yeah. Great guy. And did he also have an insurance agency?
He sold insurance. He sold cars. He sold real estate. The guys in that era had many hats.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I remember that.
If they were broke this week, they would sell something from the other business.
His office was right out on the highway.
Yeah, it was on highway down here on Main Street.
Yes, right, exactly. Just off the highway. I remember that clearly.
Did he tell you he was the grandson of one of Allen's earliest pioneers?
No, I did not know that. Well,
tell us about a patron comment that you've received about the comfort that your book has given to...
I've had many comments about The River Always Wins that have been deeply moving to me. We received one here tonight. It reminded me of a comment that I received a few months after the book came out from a woman that I go to church with. Her husband, a friend, had been diagnosed with cancer. So he was really in severe quarantine during the lockdown. He had pretty much given up hope and had to go back in the hospital for further cancer treatments. The doctors are not hopeful. She took my book. She had gotten the paperback copy of The River Always Wins and took this book and read it to him aloud twice in the hospital room, twice aloud, and said it restored his faith and his hope and desire to continue living. And it gave the doctors time to find a better cure. And now he's out of the hospital and doing better. And it's one of the most interesting things, Tom, about being an artist and a writer, is you create something and you think you know what it's about. You know, I thought I was writing a book about rivers and hope and progress and justice. But people bring their own lives to your work. Like Eileen here earlier, they find things in it that they need at that moment in their lives. And it's so deeply gratifying to find that this happens. And it happens over and over again, that you move someone in a way that stays with them in some way that you would never have anticipated. And of course, when you think about this and that story I told, all the work that went into this, and any book requires a lot of work. If it helps save that life, well, it's worth it. Of course it is. So this is something that's deeply meaningful, I think, in our work and in your work as an artist. You know, my play, The Land, I did that show once for an audience where there was a young guy in the audience who had no interest in the environmental movement. His wife told me, she said, doesn't care anything about it, know anything about it, but I'm going to bring him to see it anyway. That night after the play, he went home and joined three environmental organizations online and later became the director of sustainability for the Dallas-Fort Worth Airport. Now, you know, when you set out to write something, you can never anticipate those gifts, but you come to understand that that in large part is why you do that. Because you don't know what it's going to lead to. You know, you can go back and look. I mean, we estimate, it's a pretty good estimate, I think, that about 500,000 people saw the play I Am a Teacher live. That's a lot of people to influence. But my brother, who's a very wise man, said, the biggest blessing in your life is that you'll never know how much good you did with that play. These days, we are so overwhelmed with data and measurement and outcomes. But I can guarantee you that the most important thing to me about my work has nothing to do with the numbers of books sold or how many years I was on tour or how many people saw the play. It's the thought that that play touched so many teachers and those teachers touched their students and another generation of teachers, and that I will never know how much good I did with that. Just like with this book, you know, it's only been out less than a year, and already people are telling me how much this book has influenced them, how deeply it's moved them, how it saved someone's life, kept him hanging on. And that's a great blessing as an artist, as a human being, to know that something that you did is providing a profound lesson or goodness that you could never have anticipated when you first worked on it. And that's a beautiful thing, and I'm deeply grateful for that blessing in my life.
How has writing your three books and numerous essays and articles changed you as a person?
That's a tremendous question. Thank you. I think that artists begin with air. We begin with something here, and we make it into flesh and bone. You know, the dancer takes this desire to move, and after years of training and hard work and physical toil and pain, executes the perfect leap. The actor works on their voice, their accents, and run their lines while they're driving around, just to be able to walk on that stage and have that moment where they bring it to life. For me, going into a studio first thing in the morning with a pencil in my hand and a blank sheet of paper, you come to understand that you have the ability to walk in every day and do that. And when you finish at the end of that day, it's not that you have written something that should be chiseled in stone, it's that you have written something that is worth revising the next day. And you learn that you can do that, and it becomes a part of you. And yes, you grow in confidence. And yes, you grow in skill. But the work never ends. There's a woman named Maria Benitez. Quick story, but it's a really important story, I think, for us to hear today. Greatest flamenco dancer in the world, according to many people. She'd come to Dallas to do a flamenco scene in a Dallas opera production of Carmen, starring the great Denise Graves. So I was looking for a space that the Dallas Opera was offering for rent. We were going to do a new show of mine. I needed a place to rehearse. So I was looking at this particular rehearsal space, and this Dallas Opera person showing me around. We walked into a studio at 9:30 in the morning, and there was Maria Benitez, greatest of her kind in the world. Now, the show's already opened. She's already got the great reviews. She's already got the standing ovations. But at 9:30 in the morning, she was there in her dance shoes, on her own, working alone. And this is what comes of that work, that you understand the importance of the work. I always say that artistes sit in cafes and talk about art, but artists work. And this is what you have to do. But if you do it on a consistent basis and you sustain that, then it begins to sustain you. And you come to understand that you are linked to that work. And there's no way ever to totally be without it. You know, back when I was on tour all the time, going from city to city, state to state, catching one flight after another, you come to learn what you are capable of. You know, one time I flew into Houston to do I Am a Teacher. I got in really late. My plane was late. It was a Sunday night. I had a big show to do the next day. I got in so late that I called room service. They had one thing left a baked potato. That was it. A baked potato, which I ate alone in my hotel room at 11:30 at night. Did a show the next day before a huge audience, got a great ovation. But the night before, the guy that got the big ovation was eating a baked potato alone in a hotel room. But you do that because the work that you do the next day, going on stage, going in the dance studio, sitting down at the keyboard, sustains you. It becomes a part of who you are. And I think that's what my work has done. Is at first I had to sustain it, and now it sustains me.
My last question for you is, at Austin College, you took a variety of courses and disciplines and regimens. Can you tell us the importance of having a variety in your education?
I think it is critical, especially in today's world, where we know that young people today are likely to face many jobs in their lifetime. Jobs are changing. And it's important not only for that, though, it's important to become a truly well-rounded person. We made a real mistake in American education when we thought people had to go in one direction or the other. You're going to go to college or you're going to go into the trades. And then we decided everybody had to go to college. Well, everybody doesn't want to go to college. And what we have lost is the sense of the intelligence of the hands. So I think that being well-rounded, a bit trite, but still a valuable phrase, a useful phrase, is really important, because if you have that basis of knowledge, then as you go through your life, you can specialize here or there, or choose this field to study at a certain time, or choose this way to learn about the next thing you want to learn. So I think that's a really critical piece for us, is to understand all the different things that we can learn, and to be in love with learning, and to be a lifelong learner. And I want to take a moment and thank Shelley Williams and the late great Ken Street and Jerry Linscomb and Virginia Love, who ran the education department at Austin College. It was such a great teacher. Jack Pierce, who got me started in the ecology movement, my biology teacher at Austin College. And there were so many great teachers there. And I would say to all of you watching tonight, remember, teachers need your support and they need your love, but we also need you in the classroom, whatever that classroom might be. So I have such great memories of Austin College, and I'm so deeply grateful to what a great institution it is. And the opportunity to continue to know those professors over many years, like Shelley Williams, brilliant political science professor. Last time I was in New York and D.C., whenever I'm there, we go to lunch, we go to dinner, still close friends. And I really encourage people to find the ways that you can learn best throughout your lifetime. And Austin College helped me do that.
You and I shared the belief that the two most important things we learned at Austin College was we learned how to learn and we learned to think critically. Can you elaborate?
Well, if you learn how to learn, then you never stop learning. And the most curious minds, to me, are the most interesting people. So that's one. The other is the ability to think critically, because these days, there's so much coming at us all the time. We are so overwhelmed with information. You and I remember, there were three news channels, ABC, NBC, CBS, and PBS was an educational network. But back in the day, there were three news channels. And today, we are overwhelmed with data and information and people shouting at us. And I would just like to remind us all that the freedom of speech is of little value if we don't have the responsibility to listen. And that's one of the things I learned at Austin College, is listen to all points of view.
I'd like to do a reading from chapter 12, and we're going to feature a short video, and we'll close on that.
Chapter 7, Still Water. There is an old saying that still water runs deep, but that is not true. If it ran, it wouldn't be still. Oh, how we long to be still. We have come down from the headwaters now, the drops together. We have chiseled the course of the river through rock. We have endured the floods and the rapids, and we know the drought is coming. But soon the drops will gather, and we will move together. We'll move together toward the greater water. We will move together toward a time when the long, slow, soul-soaking rain of goodness comes upon this land. When the drops moving together will bring that goodness. The Zen master, when asked the essence of Zen, replied in three words, catch your breath. Live now, in this moment, catch your breath. Catch your breath, for soon we gather and we move together toward the greater water. From chapter 12, The Greater Water, a metaphor for the afterlife. And what do the drops learn from this? They learn to move with purpose toward goodness, and that the journey has been worth it, even the rapids and the floods and the drought. They learn that there is progress and hope in all things human, and that time is not an ultimate measure. The drops learn that the culmination of this long, arduous way is the knowledge that they are just getting started, and that we guide ourselves with the newest technology so that we can adjust our course, and as well with our eye on the North Star, under whose guidance the ancients traveled. Thank you.